Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
Hey, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, welcome to Say Yes to Life, where we learn to embrace our Catholic faith in the secular world. I'm your host, Peter Range, CEO of Ohio Right to Life, and welcome to show number 371 as we continue the fight for the dignity and value of every single human life, born, pre-born, and yours in our world today. On today's show, we are blessed to welcome for the first time Emma Waters. Emma Waters is a senior research associate for the Richard and Helen DeVos Center for Life, Religion, and Family at the Heritage Foundation. Her work focuses on family, bioethics, and reproductive technology. Waters is a former visiting fellow with Independent Women's Forum and a monthly contributor with World Magazine. Prior to this, she worked as the coalition manager of the American Moment and periodically co-hosted their podcast, Moment of Truth. Today, Emma and I will be discussing her life, in vitro fertilization, and the recent case out of the state of Alabama, which has sparked a national conversation on when life begins, fertility treatment, and IVF. So it's going to be a good show. But first, let's go ahead and take 180 seconds around the state and the nation to talk about what's happening in the pro-life movement and the news. First, tonight, President Biden will speak in Washington, D.C. to the nation in the State of the Union address. With rising inflation, a completely open southern border, and foreign wars raging, President Biden will turn to the cultural war over abortion as a reason why voters should give him a second term, as he has invited Kate Cox to be his guest tonight. Cox sued Texas last year because she demanded a late-term abortion on her baby girl, who is disabled with trisomy 18. While trisomy 18 is an incredibly challenging situation, and maybe many babies will die with the condition, others do live. Bella Santorum, for example, she's one such girl who just celebrate or who will celebrate her 16th birthday this May. You may know Bella. She's the daughter of former presidential candidate Rick Santorum. In short, the president of the United States will tonight promote a tragic situation to justify his political position of allowing abortion through all 9 months of pregnancy. So while we sympathize and empathize with moms and dads that have difficult situations, we will continue to offer them loving solutions, more loving than abortion, such as perinatal hospice. But let's not lose sight of the fact here, folks, that President Biden's position is just evil, as he even rejects legislation that would protect children after a botched abortion. All right, second, from Live Action News, in California, which is already one of the most pro-abortion states in the country, it's expanding abortion even further. Currently, physician assistants, along with licensed nurses, midwives, and nurse practitioners, can commit abortions in California. But now, they're going to be able to do it without a physician supervising. In 2013, Governor Jerry Brown, he signed legislation allowing this kind of non-physicians to commit abortions. In 2022, then, a bill was passed allowing nurse practitioners to commit abortions without doctor oversight. Look, even the American Medical Association, which is pro-abortion, has come out against this, and for good reason. A 2013 study from the Ryan Residency Abortion Training Program at the University of California, San Francisco, found that abortions committed by non-physicians are more likely to end in complication than those committed by physicians. So while this legislation may increase the number of abortions committed in California, it also means more women's lives could be put at risk of serious injury or worse. All right, finally, that's why we're trying to do the work we're doing here in Ohio, folks. May 4th, check it out and join us for the oratory contest in Sunbury, Ohio. And then May 18th, Saturday, May 18th, also in Columbus, we're partnering with over 10 different organizations around the state as we take the lead, of course. But you can sign up to hear Catholic apologist and speaker Trent Horn. He's going to be in Columbus talking about his new book, Persuasive Pro-Life. And Savannah Martin from the Bella Vita Network and Ohio Pregnancy Center Coalition will join us as MC. You can find out more about both events at ohiolife.org. All right, now on to our guest today, who is Emma Waters. Emma is a senior research associate for the Richard and Helen DeVos Center for Life, Religion, and Family at the Heritage Foundation. Her work focuses on family, bioethics, and reproductive technology policy. Today, we'll be tackling together reproductive technologies, including IVF, or in vitro fertilization. Emma, so great to have you on the show today. Thank you so much for taking time. Let's just begin with your story. Where'd you grow up, and how'd you find yourself working eventually for the Heritage Foundation?
Hi, well, thank you so much for having me on today. I've been looking forward to it. So I was born and raised in South Georgia in a very rural part of the state. We actually only had dirt roads around us, so lots of farm fields, cattle around, a rather idyllic childhood. And so growing up, I ended up studying theology and political science in undergrad, where I really became fascinated with marriage and family structure studies, but also the questions around emerging technologies. So after doing a number of internships in both the family policy and the technology policy space, I decided that it would be a really interesting idea if we merged the two together and we thought about technologies that directly influence and even change the human person. And so reproductive technology is probably one of the best examples of that. So when I came to Heritage in June of 22, so coming up on 2 years, I pitched this as an idea, really stressing not only the importance of this issue for the family, for pro-lifers, for people who are religious, but also as an emerging political fight that in the coming years was probably going to take center stage, even just as much as abortion. So this past month alone, that's really started to happen with the IVF debate.
Emma, it's fantastic you had that foresight, because you're absolutely right. And I think there's a lot maybe in the pro-life community that we don't want to touch things that we might think are kind of politically hot rod issues, whatever it may be. But I mean, that's the work that we do, really. And we have to do the job of convincing others about the reality of kind of what's going on. So let's go ahead and dive into the Alabama Supreme Court decision. Why did the Supreme Court of Alabama actually decide? What exactly did they decide in this case? And why does it matter?
Yeah, this is a great question, because obviously there's a lot of misinformation about what was actually decided in the Alabama decision and the impact on even fertility clinics in the state. So back in 2020, there were three sets of parents who were fertility clinic in Alabama. So they had already had a few children through IVF and then had a few more that they were holding for the time being. Well, the fertility clinic, who was entrusted by the parents to take care of these embryos, acted with carelessness and actually left the door unlocked for the secure embryo storage area. And so a patient from the adjoining hospital, who was not affiliated with the clinic, actually wandered in and took an entire container of embryos and shattered them on the floor. Oh. So in that moment, three sets of parents or more actually lost the lives of their embryonic children. And so they sued the fertility clinic and the hospital under Alabama's wrongful death of a minor child lawsuit, asking for legal recourse for the very legitimate and very painful loss that they had suffered. Well, when the trial court in Alabama initially heard this case, they actually ruled against the parents, saying that the embryos were the property of the parents, not persons who could be who they could use the wrongful death of a child lawsuit for. And so thankfully, the Alabama court rightly recognized that embryos are not property, but they are persons. And so they ruled in the parents' favor. And so all this ruling actually decided was that frozen embryos for the purpose of a wrongful death of a minor child lawsuit would be considered persons. It did not necessarily say that all embryos would be considered persons in Alabama. It only had to do with wrongful death suits. And it certainly did not say that IVF was banned or somehow prohibited in the state. And one of the points that they really stressed is that a number of years ago, Alabama law actually passed a few bills that said that from the moment of conception in a woman's womb, a child or that child is a person. So if there is the death of a mother through a homicide and she's carrying a child, then that child, regardless of the stage of development, was considered a person. So they simply said that if from the moment of conception inside the woman's body, you consider this embryo developing a person, then why not outside of the womb too, in in vitro fertilization? So this is actually a very logical extension of Alabama's law.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, so some really important points I want to reemphasize that you shared there, and you've written some great articles on this. I encourage you to check out heritage.org to read some of Emma's work. But the court's decision, it does not prohibit IVF, nor does it directly prohibit the destruction of embryos. It does, however, extend personhood to embryonic children and provide parents with legal recourse if they believe that the fertility clinic, through careless actions, is responsible for the wrongful death of their child. But it did kind of waken a lot of people to the reality of, oh, well, what exactly is this IVF process? And so let me say two things, Emma, before I ask you to walk us through the IVF process. Number one, I think we want to acknowledge the dignity and value of every single child who has been created through the IVF process. You know, I had individuals that I know personally that their child was created through IVF, and we celebrate her dignity, her value, her beauty. We also recognize and empathize with those who struggle with infertility and who want to have children, who want to bring life into the world. My wife and I, before we were able to start having kids every 2 years, and now I feel like we just can't stop, but we struggle with infertility early on. So we certainly sympathize and understand those are challenging situations. But Emma, could you walk us through the IVF process, if you will? Because I think when people hear it, they don't really know that all of what's involved. So walk us through the IVF process.
Yeah, so typically in the United States, if a couple is diagnosed with infertility, which generally means you're unable to naturally conceive after either 6 months or a year, oftentimes the next step is that doctors will refer parents to a fertility clinic. So at the fertility clinic, the simple version of this is if they decide that IVF, in vitro fertilization, is the best path for you, they will first set up an appointment where they actually retrieve eggs from the mother. And this already has a couple of issues and health concerns, especially because of the intensity of the hormones that are used. So actually the hormone Lupron, which if you follow the fight against gender ideology, you'll recognize Lupron is actually one of the primary off-label drugs used to stop puberty in young minors when they're wanting to control and even change the expression of that child's sex. And so that same hormone is used off-label in egg retrieval surgeries in IVF. And so they have to be very careful to ensure that the harmful effects of this hormone don't actually hurt the eggs in the process of retrieval, but it's very difficult on the woman's body. So once they have the eggs, the actual IVF process involves doctors placing sperm inside of a petri dish with an egg in hopes that the sperm will naturally fertilize the egg within that lab setting. Some techniques, the doctors actually insert the sperm directly into the egg. And others, they allow for a more, a slightly more natural process within that petri dish in a lab. Hmm. So at that point, we don't actually have data on how many embryos are created in a single round of IVF. Hmm. The most conservative estimates show that about 8 embryos can be created, but we also hear plenty of stories where up to 20 embryos are created at one time. And of course, most families are not trying to have 20 children. And if they happen to have close to that, they're usually not relying on IVF to do so. So at that point, once the embryos are created, parents have 4 decisions before them. They can implant the embryos. They can test the embryos to see if they have any genetic issues. And they can even use pre-implantation genetic testing to figure out what the sex of the child is, the possible IQ, and other secondary features like the hair color, skin color, eye color. And so some people actually use IVF in order to select their preferred child. Mm. So think most recently Paris Hilton, who created 20 embryos and then tried to select a little girl because she wanted a girl and then discarded the remaining embryos. And yet still ended up with a boy because the technology is not foolproof. And so even then she created 20 children, discard 19 of them and still not get what she ordered from the process.
Yeah.
And so as just like a big picture, I think about 75% of all clinics offer this sort of testing, and about 73% of those clinics will specifically allow it for sex selection. So if you don't implant the embryo, if you don't test the embryo, the only other two options are either A, to indefinitely freeze the embryo, or to destroy the embryo, either outright or by donating it to research. So really, once you start the process, there are very few options available to parents. And either you're implanting the child in hopes of conceiving a successful pregnancy, or the child is going to perish or remain in some sort of indefinite state of unbeing, just frozen, waiting for the next step. And in many cases, it seems as though parents are not fully aware of how many embryos could be created, and find themselves very surprised when they envision having three children through IVF, but find out that they actually have many, many more embryos that they don't know what to do with. And so the rough estimates that we have show that about over a million and counting embryos are frozen in the United States, which tells us that there are a lot of parents who have the number of children that they want to have, and yet at the same time don't feel comfortable with the idea of destroying their embryos. And so instead just continue paying every month to preserve them. And so that's a bit of a flyby, but that's generally how the fertility industry works. And that's the sort of process of decisions that parents will go through.
So there's a couple things that I want to recap there, but I also just want to ask very quickly, is there any regulation whatsoever on the IVF process in the country? Because it seems like there could be a lot of things that go wrong. So let me, before you answer that, just as you were talking, I'm writing down a little bit just concerns or red flags that go up. First of all, you're creating life in a dish, and nascent human life deserves to be respected, cared for, and the most conducive environment for a child to thrive, to survive, is within its mother's womb first and foremost. So you have life outside of the mom's sanctuary, if you will. You also have this Lupron, which's given to the woman, which has dangers in and of itself. You often in this process have more life created, more lives created than is intended by the couple to even have eventually in the future. You have what you mentioned, 75% of these groups have genetic testing a part of the process. So they're choosing, leading to the commodification of children. Well, I want a boy. I want a boy here. I want a girl here. You know, maybe I want this color eyes, whatever it might be. And often in the process too, it's the genetically strongest embryos that are chosen to be implanted to start with. So then you end up having this selective reduction process where those unwanted embryos are either frozen or simply destroyed. And then if they're not destroyed immediately or frozen, they might be sent off for, say, embryonic stem cell research. So a lot of red flags here in the process itself. I wonder if we could return then as far as what the laws are on IVF here in the country. Is it regulated at all? I mean, what does that look like? And how does that compare to maybe other Western countries? You know, maybe France, Germany, you've also written about this as well. And then if you could touch on the Louisiana law, because that was pointed to by a few pro-life organizations, SBA Pro-Life America being one of them, as to maybe a model moving forward for the country. But I even have issues with that. So, but I'll pause there. What are your thoughts on the regulation of IVF? Where do we see this in the law or not see this in the law?
Great summary. So when it comes to the laws on the federal and state level in the United States, we oftentimes refer to the fertility industry as a self-regulated and unaccountable industry. And so what we mean by that is that on the federal level, there's actually only one federal law governing the practice of IVF. And it's primarily focused on the success rates, so requiring clinics to report how many successful pregnancies per rounds of IVF that they have. And that also does require some reporting about the well-being of the child at the time of birth. So the birth rate, the health of the child, does the child have autism or maybe other issues related to it, how many children were conceived at one time. But that's primarily a reporting rule, and it doesn't actually have an enforcement mechanism. So clinics are strongly encouraged to share these statistics, but they're not actually required to do so in a way that will have any sort of like legal ramifications on them. And actually, just in January, the CDC published a proposed rule that would actually further remove accountability and reporting requirements from the clinics because it was too much of a burden to ask them to turn in correct statistics on success rates, which I am not impressed with, to say the least. Mm-hmm. But that's the primary federal law governing it. Some of the dosage and medications related to the hormonal treatments are governed through the FDA, but that is second. IVF is secondary to that. It's particularly the medications that they are overseeing. So then on the state level, there are two major fertility organizations, the American Society for Reproductive Medicine and the Society for Assisted Reproductive Technology, that will offer recommended guidelines for fertility clinics that are a part of their organization. And so oftentimes fertility clinics join as members in order to reap the benefits of being a part of a larger organization, but also have a bit of credentialing on their side saying, our techniques are approved by this major organization. You can trust us to provide a good service for you in IVF effectively. And so these organizations will offer guidelines or recommended practices that, again, are not legally enforceable, but that hopefully provide some guidance for how IVF is practiced. Mm-hmm. And then beyond that, we have a few laws, like in Colorado, they actually recently banned anonymous egg and sperm donation. So children have the right to know who their biological mother and father are, even if they use donor egg and sperm. A few states have laws on the books helping protect against fertility fraud. And then, like you mentioned, Louisiana has an embryo destruction prohibition act that's been on the books since 1986. Mm-hmm. And so this law in particular prohibits the destruction of embryos with a few caveats, but that's largely the goal of the bill. And so a lot of people, especially in this current iteration of IVF discussions, have pointed to Louisiana saying, look, you can't destroy any embryos in Louisiana, and IVF has continued to be practiced in that state. Mm-hmm. As a way of defending the Alabama decision and showing that it's not going to remove access to IVF. Mm-hmm. But aside from those laws and regulations, we actually have very little on the books governing or overseeing the practice. And instead, fertility clinics are largely self-regulated by these fertility organizations. But what's important to keep in mind here is that we're not talking about a nonprofit medical association, right, that is strictly concerned with the ethics and well-being of the parents and embryos involved. Mm-hmm. But we're actually talking about a highly lucrative industry that is making a lot of money on every single round of IVF. Mm-hmm. And has a vested interest in ensuring that as many people as possible continue to access their services with no limitation. And so there is a perverse incentive baked into this, such that parents who are genuinely struggling with the pain and difficulty of infertility and deeply desire children are walking into these settings, and in their mind, right, they're viewing the children that they hope and pray to conceive. But when the fertility industry sees them, they're seeing parents that they're going to make significant money off of. So a single round of IVF can cost anywhere from $15,000 to $30,000. And because of inconsistent success rates and oftentimes very low success rates, it can cost parents anywhere from $60,000 to $100,000 in their pursuit of a child through IVF. Mm. So, yeah, very little on the books. And any attempt, like we saw in Alabama, to bring some sort of moral and ethical regulation to the industry is largely met with an insane amount of pushback from the industry.
Yeah.
So then very briefly, on the international side, Germany provides one of the best examples where they limit the number of embryos that can be transferred into a woman to three, or no more than three. Mm-hmm. And then they say that you can't create more embryos at one time than you intend to transfer. So you can't create more than three embryos at a time. And they also have prohibitions on pre-implantation genetic testing, especially for things like the sex of the child. Mm. And so the thought behind this is that if you limit the number of embryos created, then you increase the likelihood that those embryos will actually have a chance at life, and won't be destroyed or frozen indefinitely. And then you also actually protect parents from that really difficult decision of having too many embryos. Yeah.
Yeah, no, thank you for that. And I know that you've also written in Italy, for example, they prohibit freezing of human embryos except in rare circumstances. So there is some things that are other countries we can also look to learn a little bit more about it. My issue with the Louisiana laws, I believe it allows the destruction of embryos within the first 36 hours. And so there seems to be some cognitive dissonance as far as pro-lifers. Sometimes we say, look, life begins at the moment of fertilization. But do we really believe that? Are we living that out? But folks, we've been talking with Emma Waters, Senior Research Associate in the Richard and Helen DeVos Center for Life, Religion, and Family at the Heritage Foundation, on today to talk about reproductive technologies, including in vitro fertilization. Emma, is there anything else our listeners should know? We got only got about 2 minutes left in the show, unfortunately, but any other connections do pro-lifers need to be aware about, whether that's IVF and, you know, we mentioned earlier embryonic stem cell research or its connection to surrogacy, anything of that nature that would be edifying for our listeners?
Yeah, there are two things here. The first is that you will oftentimes hear people refer to the success rate of IVF, but this only refers to the number of embryos implanted into a woman to the number of children born. But based on rough estimations from the CDC's own data, we actually find that about 4.1 million embryos are created in a given year in the United States.
Wow.
And yet only about 97,000 children are born, which means that the success rate of IVF for the embryos involved is only about 2.3%. Mm. So if for those who are pro-life and who value the integrity of the embryo, I think there's a very serious moral quandary before us where we have to ask that even if we use this technology with the most pro-life, pro-family limitations, no destruction, no testing, no freezing, we still have to ask ourselves, is it worth it for all of the embryos that are going to perish in the process, or all the embryos that are destroyed in the process by other people? Because this doesn't actually seem to be a life-affirming technology like it's often sold. But in many ways, I think ends up undermining the very goals that we have. So I think that's the final thought that I will leave people with here, is that the success rate for embryos for the unborn children is incredibly low. Yeah. And if we care about protecting the life of the unborn, I think sometimes this means making really hard decisions about what we will and won't do.
Yeah. Emma, thank you so much. Just real quick, where can people find your work, find more information on IVF?
Yes. So if you go to Emma Waters at the Heritage Foundation or Emma Waters at the Daily Signal, you'll find most of my articles linked there.
All right. Thank you so much, Emma. God be with you. And everybody, keep saying yes to life. We'll talk to you next week.